counties during Thursday, a drier day to end the week Friday. The warnings are on the website.
I'm Laura Trevelyan in Scranton, Pennsylvania, the birthplace of President Joe Biden, with a special edition of BBC World News America. With just over a week to go until the US midterm elections, we'll bring you the latest on the key races in this battleground state. Control of the US Senate could come down to how Pennsylvania votes. Here in Scranton, like in the rest of America, people are thinking about inflation, abortion rights, and the future of democracy as they decide who to vote for. From one tense election to another. In Brazil, former President Lula da Silva makes a stunning political comeback, beating the incumbent Jair Bolsonaro in the presidential election. And as Ukraine's counteroffensive continues, Russian forces step up their attacks on Ukrainian power plants. We have a special report from the front line.
Look at it. Desolation. This is what months of attritional warfare does to a town.
Welcome to World News America on PBS and around the globe. We're here in Scranton, Pennsylvania, the birthplace of President Joe Biden. It's now just over 1 week until the US midterm elections. Mr. Biden and his Democratic Party are hoping to cling on to their narrow majorities in Congress. And control of the US Senate could come down to what happens here in Pennsylvania. Later in the week, former President Donald Trump will campaign here for candidates he's endorsed. Presidents Obama and Biden will be holding rallies here in the days ahead. As the last three American presidents descend upon this state to make their case to voters, I've been asking people about the issues at the top of their minds.
Well, I was born in a small town, and I live in a small town.
Scranton, Pennsylvania, where the geography of Joe Biden's hometown reflects the political divisions of the nation. Joe Biden was victorious here in 2020, and with just over a week to go until the midterm elections, Pennsylvania is once again a pivotal state where Democrats and Republicans are chasing the swing voters.
People are just like, I need to go pick up another job to make more money. It sucks that people need to do that.
James Bodner, the head chef at Scranton's Ale House, sees how his staff are struggling with high prices. He's one of the few voters in this polarized nation who doesn't always support the same party. He voted for Donald Trump in 2016 and Joe Biden in 2020, and now he's on the fence.
I don't really know where the future of America is headed, to be honest with you. It's so split down the middle. It's either you're just extremely hard on one side or extremely hard on the other, I feel like, and there's not much middle ground.
James is busy in the kitchen these days as it's the final of the Baseball World Series, and fans of Scranton's favorite team, the Philadelphia Phillies, are coming here to watch. As he thinks about how to vote, though, the cost of living is on his mind.
I don't know many people that can afford to pay $4 or $5 a gallon per gas just to get to work and make $7.25 an hour, some people, which is crazy in 2022 that people are, you know, only making that much money.
So which way are you leaning?
I'm leaning more towards, it's tough.
College football is a Saturday afternoon ritual in Scranton. And supporters of the Lackawanna Falcons are out in force. Mothers are watching their sons play. In Pennsylvania, abortion rights are a contentious issue in the midterm elections, as Democrats claim that Republican candidates want to restrict or even outlaw abortion in the state.
I am very concerned about women's rights right now, women's health, women's opportunity to choose.
What would you like to see happen in this state on abortion?
To be honest, I'd like to see the right to have the choice.
This is hometown America here.
Robin Medeiros is a local Republican Party official. Her message to women concerned about abortion rights is they won't disappear in Pennsylvania if the state goes red.
It's not going to be completely illegal in any state. I don't think they can go that far. So I would say relax on that issue. You're okay.
This is Joe Biden's childhood home. He's used his Scranton roots to appeal to the blue-collar voters who deserted Democrats for Donald Trump. And despite his low national approval ratings, Pennsylvania is one state where Joe Biden is campaigning hard in the midterm elections. But if he wants a second term as president, even here, he's facing headwinds. Back at the football game, Scranton's most famous son is being blamed for the high gas and grocery prices.
I think he's doing an awful job. He forgot about American people. He forgot about us. He ain't worrying about Ukraine.
Can't afford a lot of bills. Got to back up on a lot of the hobbies, things like that.
Can't afford rent. Yeah, can't afford your day-to-day bills because of inflation all over the world. It's crazy. And it's tough.
As Scranton's president awaits the voters' verdict, once again, Pennsylvania is the ultimate battleground state. What happens here will show the world where America's center of political gravity lies. Well, joining me now for more on the races here in Pennsylvania is Siobhania Corbin-Johnson, who is the political director for the Pennsylvania Democratic Party. Welcome to the program, Siobhania.
Thank you so much, Laurie. Welcome to the Electric City.
We're enjoying it. Now, I imagine you are not sleeping very much this week, particularly as you have at the weekend, President Joe Biden and former President Barack Obama campaigning, crisscrossing the state. President Biden, he's not welcome in all parts of the country because of his low approval ratings. But what are you hoping he and President Obama are going to do when they come here?
Well, we're happy to have both of the president and the former president here. Pennsylvania's nickname is the Keystone State. And by having them both here, you can truly see that we are the keystone to keeping the democracy of America alive. We're really hoping that they help energize voters, help people continue to realize that this is a really important election and that there is so much on the line come 2022.
Now, Democrats are saying that the future of democracy is on the line here, and a number of election deniers are running for statewide office on the Republican side. But voters that we talk to here in Scranton are really concerned about high gas prices and groceries. Are you worried that because this election is a referendum to some degree on President Biden's term, that he's going to get punished for things like inflation and gas?
President Biden has really been putting in the work to make sure he's helping Pennsylvanians and also people across America. It's not something that's unknown to us. We feel it ourselves as well. But it is a sign of inflation. But instead of talking about inflation and how, it's President Biden's fault, what people need to realize that it's a lot of corporate greed. Inflation is not only happening here in the U.S. I'm sure it's happening in the U.K. and other countries as well. I have many friends who live overseas, and you can see that the wrong results caused by Russia and the Ukrainian war there really helped lead to the rise of inflation and gas prices
worldwide.
But when
people are only earning $7.25, which is the minimum wage here in Pennsylvania, they really feel it, don't they, when their gas prices go up just a bit and the president gets the blame.
I understand, but I will say one of the factors for our minimum wage here being so low is the Republican Party of Pennsylvania, who has kept it low. Governor Wolf has fought many times. Democrats have been on and off the floor fighting to raise the minimum wage, which should be raised to at least $15, if not more. But it's a lot of our Republican counterparts, the same ones we're trying to fight in November 2022, that want to keep it the $7.25 that it is now.
And on the future of abortion rights here in Pennsylvania, where there is a Republican candidate for governor who has a pretty staunch position where he would like to basically abolish abortion altogether, are you finding that that is leading to more young women registering to vote this time?
Yes, absolutely. Someone being told that they do not have the proper authority to over their body is a big concern for a lot of women and a lot of carriers here in Pennsylvania. Doug Mastriano is not only conservative in this fact, he is extremist. He wants to imprison any woman that has an abortion and charge them for murder.
Well, he would say that
is well.
Not his position, and indeed hasn't talked much about it in the recent times. But can I ask you that? Doug Mastriano, he's someone who was outside the Capitol on January the 6th. He's the Republican candidate for governor. Do you feel that the atmosphere here is quite fraught in the run-up to the election? Of course, former President Trump maintains that he won this state and indeed the presidency.
Well, to go back to your original point, that actually is his position. And he's even stated that women that go to another state will be tried in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania
but
if they want to
be able
to. On
the political atmosphere here in Pennsylvania, how
on the
do
political
you
atmosphere,
feel
it is definitely it is. A large rallying point. Not having the authority over one's body is something that we're making sure that people know that Doug Mastriano is very extreme on this issue and that Josh Shapiro is the only way to protect a woman's right to choose in the state. And to go back on the January 6th issue that you were talking about, Doug Mastriano was not only there storming the Capitol, he also was the one that helped plan it, along with Scott Perry, my current congressman, who also needs to be out of office.
I know that Mr. Mastriano says that he was just there at a rally and no more than that, but it just shows you that it's a very hotly contested election here in Pennsylvania. Siobhania Corbin-Johnson, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it.
Now, Russia has launched another wave of missile attacks across Ukraine. Kyiv says power and water supplies throughout the country have been badly hit, and 80% of people in the capital are now without running water. For the last week, our international editor, Jeremy Bowen, has been traveling from the battlefields of the Donbass in the east to the village of Myro-Lubivka in the south, where some of Russia's best troops are trying to stop the Ukrainian offensive. Jeremy sent us this report and a warning. It does contain very distressing details.
For Ukrainians, this is a fight for national survival. The hardest test any nation can face. It upends every life. It has ended the lives of thousands. This is Bakhmut under heavy shelling. At the moment, the center of the artillery war in Donbass.
Left is good.
More than 70,000 people used to live here. Almost all of them have left. When I was last in Bakhmut in the summer, there was shelling, but it was still more or less functional. Some buses running, a few shops open. But now, look at it. Desolation. This is what months of attritional warfare does to a town. Bakhmut's war hospital is a short ride from the mud and blood of the front line. The invasion, the casualties, the terrible cost of President Putin's attempt to subdue a people he says are the same as Russians, all of it has sharpened Ukrainians' sense of nationhood. This soldier had a lucky escape from a sniper. The bullet hit his hand. This is going to hurt, the doctor warns. The pain so far has deepened the Ukrainian will to fight. But in wars, resilience has its limits. Sustaining it needs victories, not just sacrifice. At the deadliest times, the medics work for 2 days straight, with almost no rest.
Terrible to see the pain of our soldiers, to see what kind of traumas they get in this war. The most terrible thing is to see the suffering of our country. This is the most terrible. The rest is just our job. Here I see how our boys fight. The wounds they receive ruin their lives. It depresses me more than anything else.
Just behind the front line near Bakhmut, this is a Ukrainian artillery unit's daily routine. First, reloading their missile launcher, a 50-year-old Soviet Grad B-21 that is a tried and trusted killing machine.
Ukraine's autumn mud has slowed down generations of armies. Mobile warfare will be easier when it freezes over. The Russians saw them coming.
Incoming.
Memories of peace are receding, pushed away by the debilitating routines of war.
I was woken up at 4:20 a.m. February 24th. Since then, I am fighting. I don't feel this counteroffensive is somehow special. It's the same as in the beginning. Of course, everyone is scared, but we overcome our fear and go fight. It was shelling. Nothing dramatic. We escaped the shelling. Our old lady helped us. We escaped. I don't feel the difference.
At the other end of the front line, a long day's drive southwest from Donbass, is the district of Kherson. It includes the village of Miralubivka, recaptured by Ukraine after days of hard fighting in September. We went there because residents said the Russians had terrorized them in 6 months of occupation. And because of what happened when a soldier came to this house at 11:30 on the night of the 13th of July. He dropped this bullet during the next 6 terrible hours, say these women. Now with her daughter in a safe place, that night Ludmila Mimrikova, a 75-year-old great-grandmother, was alone. Until she says the man forced his way in and raped her.
When I opened the door, he immediately punched me in the face, knocked out 2 of my teeth and broke my nose. I was covered with blood. He started beating me in the chest with his rifle butt. He was hitting my body and my head. I didn't understand what had I done wrong. He pulled my hair, threw me onto the sofa and began to strangle me, so much that I couldn't swallow water for 2 weeks. Then he began to undress me, and after, he raped me. He cut my stomach. Until now, I have scars on my stomach. The deep ones still haven't healed. Putin and the Russians will never be forgiven until the end of their world for what they did to the Ukrainians. There will be no forgiveness.
As the seasons change, the war is at a critical point. Ukrainians need a victory this winter in Kherson. Russia cannot afford another defeat. That is a formula for a battle that shapes the course of the war. Jeremy Bowen, BBC News in Ukraine.
Well, let's turn next to Brazil, where Lula da Silva has won the country's presidential election by a slim 2% margin. It's a stunning comeback. Former President Lula was unable to run in Brazil's 2018 elections because he was in jail for taking bribes and banned from standing for office, though he was later released. On Sunday night, he beat the far-right incumbent, Jair Bolsonaro. Let's get the latest from Sofia Batista in Sao Paulo. And Sofia, is Jair Bolsonaro being slow to concede that he's lost this election?
Well, he hasn't conceded yet. The whole country is waiting for him to give a speech. According to local newspaper Folha, last night after the results came in, Bolsonaro refused to speak on the phone or to meet any of his ministers. And one of his aides later that night said that Bolsonaro had gone to sleep. Now, recently we heard from Bolsonaro's son, Flavio, who tweeted, this is the first family member of Mr. Bolsonaro to tweet, and he said, "Thank you to everyone who gave Bolsonaro the biggest vote of his life. Let's keep our heads up and let's not give up on our Brazil." But, you know, the wording of the tweet is very vague.
And Sophia, when I was in Brazil a month ago covering the first round of the presidential elections, there was a lot of anxiety about what would happen, about the potential maybe for political violence if there wasn't a clear handover. But what's the atmosphere like now that it seems pretty clear that Lula da Silva has won and foreign leaders are calling to congratulate him?
Precisely. For about a year now, as you said, Bolsonaro has been sort of casting doubt on the whole voting system. Brazilians vote electronically, and Bolsonaro has been saying that it's very easy to hack electronic machines, and he's been implying that this election might be rigged against him. And, you know, this led to many people here thinking that he might not accept a defeat. And a few people were concerned that this could lead to violence in the streets or even an insurrection. But we haven't seen any of that. And if anything, a lot of people I've spoken to here in the last few hours see sort of Bolsonaro's silence as a defeat, as him admitting defeat. But of course, we'll have to wait and see. Bolsonaro is going to give a speech in the next few hours and everything will become clearer then.
Sophia in Sao Paulo, thank you. Well, in other news now from around the world, the man suspected of attacking Paul Pelosi, the husband of the US Speaker of the House, with a hammer, has been charged with assault and attempted kidnapping. Nancy Pelosi has said she and her family have been traumatized by the attack. The suspect, David DePape, will face arraignment on Tuesday. Investigators in South Korea are examining video footage from more than 50 sources to try to find out how 154 people who were celebrating Halloween were killed in a crush in Seoul. There are growing questions about why the police failed to disperse the crowds as they gathered in the city's narrow alleyways on Saturday evening. Police in India have detained 9 people after the collapse of a bridge that killed at least 140 people. Several employees of the company involved in the bridge's maintenance were among those arrested. City officials say they hadn't issued any certificate of safety following repairs that were made to the bridge. Well, let's circle back now to the upcoming US midterm elections in 1 week's time. From our position high above the city of Scranton, Pennsylvania, birthplace of the current president. Control of Congress is at stake in a week's time. Let's talk more about the significance of all of this with Ron Christie, a Republican strategist who was formerly an advisor to President George W. Bush. And Ron, welcome here to Scranton. It's great to see you.
Well, good to see you too.
So, Ron, we have President Biden coming here to campaign this week with former President Obama. Former President Trump will be here on Saturday, who still won't concede that he lost this state in 2020. Why all of these big shots here in this state?
Well, good evening once again to you, Laura. The stakes couldn't be higher when you look at control of the United States Congress, right? You have a very bitterly contested election for the United States Senate, where the Republicans think they just need one more seat. And is it going to be Mehmet Oz? Is it going to be John Fetterman, the lieutenant governor? And the Democrats are bringing in all the big guns. And I have to say, I spent a lot of time walking around this town today, and this city, 2 hours away from New York, 2 hours away from Philadelphia, is really, I think, the bellwether of where a lot of Pennsylvanians are kind of looking and saying, who do we want to represent us? Who do we trust to represent us in the United States Senate? So, yep, you're going to see all the heavy hitters in the next couple of days.
And to what extent is this election a test of the influence of former President Donald Trump? Because the two marquee candidates for governor and Senate are basically handpicked by Donald Trump. He was very influential in their primaries. What are you picking up about them and how they might do?
You know, the interesting thing, Laura, I would say to you, for the people I've talked to today, they're like, we don't want Trump coming in here and messing with our election. We want Pennsylvanians to represent Pennsylvanians. And Donald Trump had his time, he had his due, but we don't want him coming in here. Now, the flip side of your question is very interesting. They want Barack Obama coming in. They want President Biden coming here. So I thought that was really interesting when I heard today from the folks that I spoke to that they don't want Trump coming here, but they want the Democrats coming here.
Could this be a classic election, though, Ron, where Americans split their tickets? They vote, say, for a Democratic candidate for governor here in Pennsylvania, but then they vote for the Republican candidate for senator.
I do. And, you know, the folks I spoke to today said that, well, Dr. Oz doesn't really live in Pennsylvania. His sister has a house here. We probably think he lives in New Jersey. But they're really worried and really concerned about the health of the Lieutenant Governor John Fetterman. And they're like, not so sure I can pull the lever there. So to your point, yeah, I think there could be ticket splitting. from governor to the Senate race.
And what is the result here in Pennsylvania, Ron, going to mean for potentially the future of President Biden and his ability to govern or not for the remainder of his term?
100%. Look, for having gone to college in Pennsylvania here, I think it's very interesting when you look at the suburbs of Philadelphia, right, Montgomery County, Delaware County, where Republicans never had a chance to win, that we've won in the past. And I'm looking at those counties and saying, are Republicans in play here? And I think the answer to that is yes. And I think that will have a remarkable impact on how 2022 shapes out and then immediately 2024.
Ron, a final question. What's your prediction for Republicans here in this state? How do you think they could do? Pick up House seats, even a Senate seat?
Both. Both. Yeah, I think Republicans, you hear about the quote red wave. I think Republicans are going to do very well here in Pennsylvania and in the Midwest.
Ron Christie, thank you so much for being with us. And as we go tonight, let's leave you with these images of Scranton, this historic city flanked by the gorgeous Moosic Mountains. As the fall begins to fade, voters here, as Ron was saying, may well decide the fate of President Biden's agenda. Control of the U.S. Senate could rest on which way Pennsylvanians vote. Not for nothing is it called the Keystone State. Throughout this week and on election night, when Ron will be one of our analysts, we'll bring you special coverage of the U.S. midterm elections from the BBC's unique global perspective, explaining what the results mean for America and the rest of the world. I'm Laura Trevelyan in Scranton, Pennsylvania. Thanks for watching.
Good evening. It's been another mild day. In fact,